It's nice to have the hush. A very good morning to you all. It's lovely to see you come through the rain and the storms to come and join us this morning. For those of you who didn't risk the rain, I know some of you have COVID as well. It's good that you're joining us on Zoom. So thank you for joining us on Zoom. It's good to see John and Betty and Eric and Audrey and Angela. Who else can I see? It's good to welcome you. Liz is there, Tricia. It's good to see you and welcome you on Zoom this morning as well. It's been an unusual time in our country at the moment. And I didn't realise we had a prophet amongst us. But John Godfrey, as I came in this morning, he said we need to change the music. And I said, why do we need to change the music? He said, well, as I was driving this morning, it was raining really heavily. Who got the rain this morning?
I did.
Yeah. And what came to his mind, or I don't know whether it was on the radio, he suddenly heard the old hymn, the old song, Our God Reigns. Don't know whether you felt that in the rain this morning. But actually, the truth of that needs to ring true with what we are going through as a nation and as a country. It has been a very unusual, I was going to say week, but it's been an unusual lot longer than that. And in a sense, we could come in despair. We could come worrying about what that means for our mortgages, for our future, for our families. We could come with fears and worries. But this morning, we come. And we come believing that our God reigns. On one occasion, a teacher of the law, an expert in the law, came to Jesus and asked him about this kingdom, asked him about this rule and reign of God and how he could be part of it. And Jesus says, it's written in the law. How do you read it? The expert in the law replied with these words, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this and you will live. That is our call today, to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And despite what's going on around in our world, we can still love God with everything we have because we trust him, because he reigns, he is in control. So can we stand together and can we say that short verse of why we've come here today? We've come here because we trust God and we're going to love him with all our heart and soul and strength and mind. So I wonder whether we can encourage one another to do that this morning. So we're going to speak this verse to one another. So you can look around at other people as you speak this. Okay. So we're going to say, and you may, usually when I do this, we have some action. So you begin with a love heart. Okay. So turn to the person next to you and say, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. Have you got that? We need to remind people to do this because it's difficult, isn't it? It's hard when things are chaos around us, but that's why we've come. Let's try it one more time, can we? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we have come today to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And if we're honest, that's a bit difficult with all that's happened this week, with all that we're thinking about, with all that we are struggling with. But we come to trust you. We come because we believe you are God, that you reign, that you're in control, and that you love us, and you care for us, and you will provide for us. And so we are determined today, in the way that we sing, in the way that we listen, in the way that we pray, in the way that we worship all together, that we're going to do it with our heart, soul, mind, and strength because we love you. So help us by your Spirit to enable us to love you with all we have for what you have done. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And as part of the Christian tradition, and certainly the Old Testament, the way we love God is by using this lovely word called hallelujah. And hallelujah means we're going to praise God, we're going to love God, we're going to declare his goodness, we're going to trust him. And so we're going to begin this, our worship together, by saying we're going to raise a hallelujah. In the presence of all that we're going through, we're going to trust God, we're going to love God, and we're going to praise him. So let's together, with your heart, soul, mind, and strength, let's sing this song to our Heavenly Father. this morning, Jesus, we raise a hallelujah. We raise that our God reigns. We raise that our God is in control. We raise a hallelujah over our national events. We raise a hallelujah over our economic crisis. We raise a hallelujah over our world, over Iran, over Ukraine, over Russia. We raise a hallelujah that God reigns. He is Lord of all. But this morning, we raise a hallelujah over our life events, over our worries, over our struggles. We raise a hallelujah over our school struggles. We raise a hallelujah over our health struggles. We raise a hallelujah over our children. We raise a hallelujah over our parents. We raise a hallelujah over our friends. We raise a hallelujah over our circumstances and situations. We raise a hallelujah over our finance. We raise a hallelujah. Our God reigns, and he is for us, and he loves us, and his kingdom comes, and his justice and rule and reign will come. And in the meantime, he will provide what we need each day. We pray for those grieving loss of parents. We pray for those who are under the hospital with worries of the uncertainty for children. We pray for Molly. We pray for those waiting outcomes from agencies. We pray for those who've got neighbours whose grandchildren are in hospital with water on the lungs. We raise a hallelujah over all these things, knowing that you care, you will provide. And so we simply say together the prayer, Jesus, that you taught us to pray for your kingdom, for your will, but also for our daily needs. As we say together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And as we raise a hallelujah, we need a new vision. A vision of Jesus. A vision of him who has conquered death. The vision of the one who is reigning over all. And may that vision be imparted to our hearts, souls, and minds today. Let's sing, Be Thou My Vision.
Thou in me dwell.
Jesus, come to us, come into our hearts, fill our hearts, where our hearts have been divided, come and pour your love into our hearts. Jesus, come to us, may we see you, may we feel you, may we know you, and may we trust you. Just a few notices to say. Susie, I see we have a cardboard tube here. Do you want to talk about a cardboard tube? This looks an impressive one. Can anyone outdo that one? I don't know whose it is. Who brought that one? Oh, well done. Do you want to...
Yeah, really big. You've got to get Can anybody yodel?
Brilliant. And do come along. It is for families. It's a family event. So anyone with families, come along. If you haven't got a family, I can find you a family if you really want to come along. Okay, that will be fine. But it's great to come along. It's 5:30, I think, to 7:00. It'll be great to come. There'll be refreshments. There'll be fun. There'll be games and lots of things. So do come along. That's on Saturday. And if you see on the advert, there is a prize for the one who comes most brightly dressed. Okay, so you may want to think about that. Good. Just another important notice, particularly for those who are church members. We, as you know, we have got a church meeting coming up, and as part of that, there is going to be election of faith leaders. We have two of our faith leaders due to stand down. Nick is not wanting to stand again. Judith, I think, might be persuaded, but we are still short of faith leaders. So it's something to really pray about and think through. If there's any in the church that you recognize as a leader who can help support my ministry, who can support the direction and vision of the church, and who is a person of prayer who can lead us through, please talk to them. It will be lovely to have more people to support the leadership and the direction of the church. Unfortunately, I forgot to print off any nomination forms out this morning. I will email them around this afternoon. If you don't get email and you're not good at things and you want me to drop a nomination form off, let me know. You do need to get the permission of the person you're nominating, and there needs to be two people who nominate that person. I hope that makes sense for those who need to know the how it makes sense. But do pray as we as a church really consider the direction and future of the church and those who can step up and support that. In Luke chapter 10, we read this teacher of the expert of the law said, how do we read the law? How do we read the Old Testament? How do we understand God's kingdom and rule and reign? And the answer was, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. You have answered correctly, Jesus replied. Do this, and you will live. But this man wanted to justify himself. And so he asked Jesus, who is my neighbor? And then Jesus told them this very familiar story.
Good Samaritan. So part of God's story is about a Good Samaritan, and it goes like this. When Jesus lived on earth, he often told stories to teach us things. Stories that teach a lesson are called parables. One day, Jesus told a parable about a good guy from a place called Samaria, a Good Samaritan, to a group of Jewish people. It all started when a Jewish expert in the law asked Jesus, what must I do to receive eternal life? Basically, he was asking, what do I have to do to be perfect? Since this guy was an expert in the law, he thought he already knew how to be perfect because he knew all the rules. He just wanted to see what Jesus would say. Of course, Jesus knew what the man was thinking, so he asked him, what is written in the law? The man said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Love him with all your strength and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as you love yourself. So he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus answered him by telling this story. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Everybody listening was Jewish, and they could probably all picture the exact road Jesus was talking about. He continued, a priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. You might expect a priest, who was supposed to serve God, to help, but he didn't stop. Then Jesus said, a Levite came to the place and saw him, but he passed by on the other side too. Levites were assistants to priests, so maybe you'd expect them to help too, but he didn't stop either. Finally, Jesus said, a Samaritan came along. Remember, a Samaritan is a person from Samaria. That's near Israel, where God's family, the Jews, lived. But here's the thing, Jews and Samaritans didn't get along. In fact, nobody hearing this story would ever expect a Samaritan to help because Samaritans and Jews couldn't stand each other. But Jesus said, when the Samaritan saw the man, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out money and gave it to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will pay you back for any extra expense you have. Then Jesus asked, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? The expert in the law didn't even want to say the word Samaritan, but he admitted the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. In other words, go and love everyone, even people we don't like or people who everybody else wants to avoid. See, when we show love, we're obeying Jesus. Obeying God doesn't mean just doing what his rules say. It means loving him more than anything and showing his love to every single person that we meet. And that's the story of the Good Samaritan. So in case you missed it, here's the quick version. A man asked Jesus how to get eternal life. Jesus said, what is written in the law? The man said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Love him with all your strength and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as you love yourself. Then the man asked, who is my neighbor? Jesus told a story. If you missed Jesus' story, here's the quick version. A Jewish man got beat up. A priest walked by. A priest assistant passed by. A man from Samaria actually did help. That was a surprise. Jesus had taught them, we obey God when we show love. And that's part of God's story.
I'm sure we all know that story well, but if we love God and we know that God loves us, we need to be those who love others, love everyone. And I hope that's a good thing to reflect upon. We're going to be looking at that later on with us. But the children and young people are about to go out for their classes. But as they do, let's love them. Let's, as they go, shake their hand, give them high five. Turn to the people next to you as well and welcome them. Let's love one another. This community should be the most loving community as we love Jesus. So let's show a bit of love to one another. Not embarrassing your son by giving them a hug may not be the most loving thing to do, Linda. But let's love one another. If the children would like to go the way to their classes, give them a high five. Let's just catch up with one another as they go. And love one another around. Catch up. See how everyone's doing. You're allowed to talk to each other as they go. That's all right. Cool. We're going to continue to meet God. We're going to continue to experience God's love as we continue our worship together, as we praise God. So let's continue in loving God with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, because it's only as we love God that His love can enable us to love those around us. So as we gather, let's just worship Jesus. Let's allow Him to come and minister to our needs, that we may be filled with the love of God to love others. So let's stand together, and I've totally forgotten what we're singing now, but we are going to stand. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Let's worship Jesus. Thank you.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray.
Jesus, we are your church. We need your kingdom here. We need you to rule and reign and begin with us. We need you to change our hearts. We need to hear your voice. We need you to heal our lives. We need you to reign in us. And so, Jesus, we enthrone you. We proclaim you our King. And we ask you to build your kingdom here this morning. We ask you to reign over sickness and poverty and injustice. We ask you to reign over fears and anxieties. We ask you to reign over depression and oppression. Jesus, we ask you to comfort. We ask you to wipe away tears. We ask you to mend broken lives. We ask you to fill those despairing with joy and hope and peace. May your reign, your loving reign, your generous reign, your all-sufficient reign, come and touch our lives. Jesus, you said, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and have fellowship with them. Lord, we need your reign, we need your fellowship. And we hear your invite. We invite you in. Rule in us. Lord, there are mountains that need to be moved in our lives. Changes that need to happen. Only you can do that. So reign in us as we wait upon you this morning. say hallelujah. Moment of quiet as we allow the Spirit to move, to fill you, to cleanse you, to heal you. Lord, as you said to the disciples when you were on earth, do you want to leave as well? Because it was such a hard teaching. But Peter replied, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Don't go. Don't give up. Don't wander away. Receive afresh this morning those words of eternal life. And may they give you peace, health, healing, hope, and joy. In Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to be looking a little bit at the story of the Good Samaritan that we had with the children. The end of that story, Jesus said, go and do likewise. Go and do. And we're continuing our series looking at what it means to be with Jesus, to become like Jesus, and to build the kingdom of Jesus. And we're basing that on Micah 6, where it says, he has showed you what the Lord requires of you, to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. We looked at the walk humbly with God, how important it is to be with Jesus daily and weekly as we come to worship. We realize that as we are with Jesus and spend time with Jesus, we become like Jesus and we love mercy and compassion and grace and forgiveness. And I want to move on now in our series to look, what does it mean to do justice? What does it mean to build God's kingdom here? What does it mean to build it in this church? What does it mean to build it in our community in Wallingford? What does it mean to build it in our country? And what does it mean to build it in our world? What is that kingdom of God and how can we build it? How can we do justice? We're going to take a number of weeks to look at this. But I want to just introduce it today through the story of the Good Samaritan and this phrase in Micah. In the AD 90s, there was an emperor called Domitian, and he ruled very well across the world. He sought to be the saviour of the world. He brought peace and prosperity. And because he brought peace and prosperity and ruled the empire world, he saw himself as the saviour of the world. He saw himself as the God-like Messiah and saviour. And so therefore he wanted people to honour him and understand that he was the saviour. He was the one who brought justice. He's the one who brought peace. The Pax Romana he bought. And so he wanted people to honour him. And so he would ask everybody to say, Caesar is Lord. Caesar is the king. He is the saviour. He has brought peace and justice. The early Christians then had a challenge. And they would reply, when they were asked to say, Caesar is Lord, they would simply risk their very life and say, no, Jesus is Lord. Many of them were persecuted, many lost their lives by saying, Jesus is Lord. And as we come to this understanding of what do justice means, I'm sure ruler Domitian thought he was doing justice. I thought he was bringing peace. He was bringing justice across the world. He was following his agenda of rule and reign. So the question when we ask, we are called to do justice, the first question we have to ask ourselves is, whose justice? There are many different types of justice and view of justice. But the question is, if we are to do justice, the question is, whose justice are we doing? And that's the story of Micah that this phrase that we're looking at comes from. This book of Micah is when the people of God, the Israelites, had moved away from God and they'd brought about injustices. There was poverty happening. There were rulers who were ruling unfairly and unjustly. The poor were being trodden on. Houses were being taken from people. The whole country was falling apart. Justice was not being seen. And Micah, in chapter 1, the prophet Micah went around, and in chapter 1, he gets to the heart of the problem of injustice, the cause of the injustice in the nation. And we read this in chapter 1, verse 3. Lord, look, the Lord is coming down from his dwelling place. He comes down and treads on the heights of the earth. Listen to that phrase, remember it. The mountains melt beneath him and the valleys split apart like wax before the fire, like water rushing down a slope. All this is because of Jacob's transgression, because of the sins of the people. What is Jacob's transgression? Is it not Samaria? Doesn't make much sense, does it? What is Judah's high place? Is it not Jerusalem? Therefore, I will make Samaria a heap of rubble, a place for planting vineyards. I will pour her stones into the valley and lay bare her foundations. All her idols will be broken to pieces. All her temple gifts will be burned with fire. I will destroy all her images, since she gathered her gifts from the wages of prostitutes. As the wages of prostitutes, they will again be used. Prophetic fairy language that we don't quite grasp. But if we actually understood what Micah was saying, as the people would have understood, we would have seen the problem. What the problem in Samaria was idolatry. They built their own high place. They built their own temple. And it's now saying that what happened in Samaria is now happening in Jerusalem. The temple in Jerusalem, the place where God was meant to be worshipped and honoured, was becoming a place of idols. The stones that they talked about that needed to be toppling, they were the idols in there. The prostitution is the idea of the worship of other gods within the temple. And what Micah is saying is the cause of all the injustice that we read about through chapters 2, 3, and 4 are a result of idolatry. A result of changing who you worship. Looking at a different set of justice and rules. And actually the thing we need to come to when we think about doing justice, we need to think, whose justice are we talking about? Who decides? Who rules? Who reigns? Who is it that we're following? Whose standards are we judged by? Chapter 4, verse 5 of Micah tells us this. All the nations may walk in the name of their gods, but we will walk in the name of our Lord, our God, forever and ever. So as we look at this understanding that we need to do justice, the question is, who is our king? Whose justice are we talking about? Who are we following? Whose rules, whose laws, whose understanding of justice are we doing? And in the book of Micah is the challenge to us. If we're talking about justice, we need to choose whose. And we need to make sure that God, our King, our God is revealed in Jesus. That's the justice that we are talking about. And we need to see, as we'll see, what that justice is. But in a minute, but we all need to say that actually this is justice, is an action, not an attitude. The attitude is to love mercy. That's our attitude, but our action is to do justice. We're not to talk about justice. We're not to put justice on Facebook. We're not to tweet justice, but we are to do justice. This is walking in the way of the Lord. This is living His way, His standards, His justice. We are to do, to walk, to live justice. So what is justice? What do we mean by justice? We all come with our view of what justice is, but the question we need to ask is, what is God's justice? To do justice, the Hebrew word is mishpat, with the idea of God's justice. And what does that justice mean? It really means that it's justice for all. Leviticus 24:22 talks about this mishpat, this justice, not just for the people of God, not just for the Israelites, but for the foreigner and for the alien. This is justice that is for all. This is a justice that cares for everyone. Zechariah 7, verse 10 to 11, talks about what this justice is. It's about caring for the poor and the fatherless and those who have no one to help. Our God is justice, is to care for all. Let's read Psalm 146. I could show you lots of places, but let's just look at a few to talk about what this justice is we're talking about. Psalm 146. Let's read verse 7 to 9. He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but frustrates the ways of the wicked. This is our God. He's a God who wants justice for all, equity for all, for the widow, for the fatherless, for the poor, for those overlooked. Again, Deuteronomy 10, we could read this over and over again, but let's look at Deuteronomy 10, verse 17 to 18. If I can find it. Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 17 to 18 says this. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing. And you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt. This is God's justice. This is mishpat. This is what we're to do. It's to care for all. It's to show that equity, that justice for all, for the poor, for the vulnerable, for the widows, for the foreigner, for the alien, for everyone. There needs to be equity. There needs to be justice. There needs to be equality. There needs to be care. There needs to be provision. That is God's justice. And if you have time, look at Job 29, 12 to 17, or Job 31, 13 to 28. This Job figure actually in these passages helps us understand the heart of God for the poor, the fatherless, the widow. Job is saying, I've cared, I've looked after, I've not mistreated, I've dealt with everyone the same. That is justice. And we have our view of what justice might mean, but when we talk about whose justice, when we talk about God's justice, it is about doing justice, caring, fair, justice, equality, sharing, generosity. This is justice. It's far bigger than we see it in our Western world that we get justice when we get what we deserve. That's not justice of the Bible. The justice of the Bible is generosity, is equality, is care, is sharing, is giving. That's justice. And let's not come with some patronizing nonsense that we're just people, just because we do what's fair and right and we uphold the law. That is not the justice of the Bible. You are just when you give to the poor, where you share your bread, where you visit the prisoner, where you include and welcome everyone, you give and sacrifice and care, whatever the cost. That is justice. That is whose justice we are talking about. The problem often is we like to use the law of God, we like to use the Bible to justify our actions and not to do justice. That was the whole point of the story of the Good Samaritan. He came and he wanted to know what was life, how should we live for God? And he was told, what are the commandments? What is God's way? What is God's justice? He said, that is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said, yes, go and do, and you will live. But then we read this lovely phrase that this expert of the law wanted to justify himself. Wanted to justify himself. Wanted to think he's actually doing all right. He's actually fulfilling it. And he's actually okay. And so he comes to Jesus with the follow-up question. Who is my neighbor? Who is it the one I have to be generous to and care for and feed and love like myself? And so Jesus tells them this story of the Good Samaritan to tell us what justice is. Not that we can justify ourselves, but what the justice is to do. And he tells this story, this parable, which sums up all the teaching of the justice of God in the Old Testament. And it is ultimately justice. Can I suggest, we looked at it in depth a bit in the last week, we're not really talking about do justice and love mercy, because as we will see in this parable in the Old Testament, that justice actually is love for all. If you want a definition of justice, God's justice, love for all, would be a very good starting point. That's the story of the Good Samaritan. Love for anyone and everyone. Who was the one who was the neighbor? It was the Samaritan who cared for his enemy, who did right, who showed love to the foreigner, to the alien, to the one who probably wouldn't even have wanted his help, but would rather have died in that place than say, a Samaritan saved me. That is justice. That is God's justice, a love for all. And can we please, as we love God, can we love our neighbor? Can we have a love for all? Can we have a generous love, a welcoming love, a giving love, a just love that stands up for everyone? And over this series, we're going to be looking at racism, sexism, homophobia, all those things that are part of our church. We have to stand up and say, if we are to do justice, we have to love all. And we need to deal with these things because God's justice is a love for all, standing for all. And it's a love, as the book of James tells us, is not just to see, is not just to say. I will show you my faith by what I do. It is a love for all. It is a love in action. That's the second part of justice. It is meeting the material, physical, economic needs of all. Yeah, you heard me right. Don't let that go over your heads. This is what justice is. It's meeting the material, physical, economic needs of all. It's acting. It's acting and doing. Justice. And if you're not challenged, if you're not feeling as if we are not being just, you haven't understood what mishpat is. You haven't understood the parable of the Good Samaritan. Justice is love for all. It's love in action. It is doing, going, sacrificing. But so often, we want to use the Bible to justify our own actions. What do we say? I'm just. I don't do anyone harm. The Levite didn't do any harm. The priest didn't do any harm. They didn't beat up the man. They didn't do any harm. But that's not justice. Justice is acting, is doing good, is caring, is giving. You say, well, charity begins at home. Begins with my own, with my family, with those I'm responsible for. Begins with my own people. It's not justice. The Samaritan and the Jew were at loggerheads. They hated each other. Charity begins not at home. Charity begins where the need is. Charity begins where you come across an injustice, where someone's not loved and cared for, when someone's needs are not met. Who is my neighbor? Who is my family? Who is my home? It's wherever I come across a need that needs to be met. Well, you say, well, the people I come across, they don't have extreme poverty. Okay, it's a bit hard for them. It's difficult for them, I know that. But they're going to be okay. What does Jesus say? Love your neighbor. What did he say? As yourself. So look at yourself. How are you loving yourself? How are you providing for you and yours? That's the love you show to your neighbor. You show to everyone. you love yourself by giving you those extra treats, that's how you to love your neighbour. Do you love yourself by being generous at birthdays and Christmas? That's how do you love your neighbour. Do you love yourself by going and buying that nice extra, it's like my new suit or whatever it is? That's how you to love your neighbour. But you say, well, I've tried. And they don't seem to respond well. They don't seem to appreciate it. In fact, sometimes I get quite a negative reaction when I try and help. I'm sure as that Samaritan lifted up that Jew, he didn't want to be helped. If he had a voice, he would say, leave me here. If he had a voice, he would say, go and get someone else to help me. The Samaritan ignored the cries. He lifted him up. He put him on his donkey. He bandaged up his wounds. He took him to the hospital, the local inn. And he paid for that local inn to care for him fully. That is justice. That is love for all. That is love in action. That is love that is not limited to my friends and to my family. That is justice. Feeling challenged this morning? I am. That's God's justice. That's God's care. What does that mean for me? How I use my money, how I use my time, how I meet the needs of others. I've got to do, I've got to act. But the question is, do I really believe in the justice of this God of the Bible? Is that the justice I want? Can't I choose the justice of the Tory party? Can't I choose the justice of the Labour Party? Can't I choose the justice of an economic system? Can I not choose a justice of a political or philosophy system that won't demand as much? Yeah, you could. But don't say it's Christian justice. Don't say it's doing justice. So why would anybody? Why would anybody choose to live this way? Because ultimately, let us be brutally honest this morning. As I look into my heart, I don't want to do that justice. Because actually, I would rather choose my own justice system. I would choose what I want to do, how I want to do it, when I want to do it. I want to be my own king. I want to be my own authority. I want to define my own justice. And actually, that's the problem. The problem is, all of us have rejected God and his justice and have said, I want to choose my own. Decide. I want to call the shots. I want to decide what I want to do. Because ultimately, I am not like the Good Samaritan. I'm the priest and the Levite. I'm selfish. I want to determine my own terms, my own authority. I want to be in control. I want to choose. And I don't want anyone telling me what justice is. A bit of honesty there for you. That's what you're thinking. I know you are. You're the same as me. The problem is, the Bible calls that selfishness. It has a posh term for it. Sin. That selfishness, that decision to choose for yourself, that I. In the book of Judges, we looked at Ruth a few weeks ago. This, at that same time, was the book of Judges. And at the end, the book of Judges says, in that day, there was no king, and everyone did as they saw fit. So you, that's me. That's our country. That's our society. That's our world. We're choosing our own justice. We do what we think is fit. But the Bible says, that selfishness, that sin, that rejection of God and his justice and righteousness will ultimately result in death. The wages of sin is death. That's what the Bible says. The consequence of living that way will be death of our society, death of our culture, death of justice, death of family, death of society, death of ourselves. It will destroy us. But the good news is this justice is proved to be the right way. Because the story of the Good Samaritan reminds me of someone I hated, I rejected, I ignored. Someone that actually I wanted to keep my distance from as far as possible. But it reminds me of a story that I got myself into a mess. This selfishness within me and within my culture and with my society actually was damaging, was actually destroying me to such an extent that it was overwhelming. And the sin and the selfishness within me was killing me within. And yet someone I hated, someone I ignored, someone who I did not want part of my life, came down from heaven. Or in the story of the parable, didn't come from Jerusalem, but went to Jerusalem. He rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. They praised him as the king they wanted, but he wasn't the king they wanted. And so they crucified him on a cross. He paid the greatest sacrifice of all to bring me forgiveness, to deal with the selfishness and sin within, to bring a forgiveness, a healing, a joy, and a peace, and a life, an eternal life that no one can take away. And that Jesus was the Good Samaritan who came to me when I didn't want him. Forgive me, to cleanse me, to give me life, to heal me, to put me back together. And that is why I know that this justice, this love for all, this love in action, this love unlimited is the only way, because this God revealed in Jesus is a God who did not just teach it, did not just tell us how to do it. He came, he lived it, he died for me, he forgave me, he comes to live in me, and he comes to live out this generous justice of love for all to everyone. And it changes me. And therefore, I not only want to walk humbly with Jesus, I don't only want to love, mercy and forgiveness and compassion and grace and just rejoice at God's love for me and all. I actually want to do justice. I want to love. I want to care. I want to give my life in service of the other. That is the kingdom of God. That is justice. That is, as Tim Keller in his book calls it, generous justice. Because that's what we're talking about. It's tough. It's hard. And it can only happen when you've seen it revealed in Jesus to heal and change and forgive you and put you back together. Hopefully, I don't know. But the Jew, the unnamed Jew who was healed and put back together, I wonder whether his life was changed. I wonder whether he decided to help Samaritans. I wonder whether he helped to care and give and to sacrifice for others. I wonder whether he, from that moment on, ever walked past someone in need. I hope not, because I hope the love of Jesus for us changes us forever. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, as we look at justice in these coming weeks, as we deal with some difficult issues like politics and poverty and racism and sexism and all these areas, may we learn what it is to build your kingdom of justice. May we have an understanding of justice that is love for all, love in action, and love unlimited. But Lord, we cannot agree to this type of justice until we have had it demonstrated to us in the person of Jesus. And so, Lord, we come today and we look inside at our hearts and see the selfishness, the greed, the idolatry, what the Bible calls sin. And Lord, as we see your justice, we come and fall so far short. We see the mess in our lives and in our families and in our world as a result. But Lord, your generous justice did not leave us in that position. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Lord, this morning, as we look at justice, Lord, we see that we fall short. And the justice we deserve is condemnation, judgment, wrath. But Lord, we want to thank you this morning that the justice we receive is love, is forgiveness, is being put back together, and is an unlimited love. We believe in Jesus. May we receive that life, that we may walk humbly with God, that we may love mercy, but we may also do justice. What does it mean to believe in Jesus? Just means that. It's to say, I trust you, Jesus, for forgiving me. I trust you, Jesus, to change me. Because I cannot do it myself. I'm a foreigner, I'm an alien, I deserve nothing. But I trust. I believe. May your love come into my heart now. And for some of you this morning, you've never received that love. You've seen God do justice on that cross. You just need to receive that now. Just revel in God's mercy and his love and his forgiveness and his putting you back together. You can't do it yourself, however hard you've tried in these last years. Jesus wants to come and do it now for you. Just let him. Because when you do that, you want to spend the rest of your life serving this King. This King who has shown you what justice is. We're going to close our service by singing that lovely hymn, King of Kings, Majesty. I live to serve your majesty. I live to serve your justice. I live to serve this way of living. What sort of king and kingdom are you looking for? Have you found it? Can I offer you Jesus, his king, his kingdom, his rule of generous, loving justice, of mercy, of forgiveness, of welcome, of peace and of joy? And know that he will provide all that you need as we wait for his kingdom in this world. He will give you your daily bread. He will be enough. I ask you, will you choose King Jesus? Will you choose his kingdom? Stop looking, stop searching, you will not find better. Lord Jesus, risen Lord Jesus, King Jesus, You conquered death to show that your kingdom will last forever. Your kingdom will come to this earth. One day every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. But Lord Jesus, right now, on this day, I choose you to be my king. I choose your justice. I choose your love. I choose your kingdom. And Lord, as we go into this week, having received your generous justice and your love and mercy, may we live to serve that majesty. May we live to serve your justice. May we live to serve your kingdom. And may people be amazed how beautiful, how kind and compassionate King Jesus is and his kingdom. Amen. God bless you. Do stay for tea and coffee. If you want to talk to Alida, please do. If you would love prayer ministry, Gail and Susie are here. Be delighted to pray for you. Have a good half term, but do stay for tea and coffee.